those who don't know me, my name is Dennis Shafter. I have been absent for a couple of weeks. I invite you to open your Bibles to the Book of Mark, chapter 1. We're going to look at mostly at Mark, but look at the four Gospels, Mark, Matthew, Luke, and John. Some people wonder why God provided four Gospels, but each of those Gospels gives us a different insight into the life and the ministry of Jesus Christ. Matthew talks a lot about Jesus being the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and the Messiah, and all the prophecies that pointed to the fulfillment of Jesus. Whereas Luke is really writing to marginalized people, the Greeks and the Gentiles, who feel like they're outsiders. And John is writing to the Gnostics in the church, what we would call today the New Agers, helping them to understand that Jesus is both fully human and fully divine. In Gospel of Mark, he's writing to the people of Rome, to the believers of Rome, the beleaguered believers of Rome, sharing Jesus as the suffering servant, and sharing the importance of discipleship. And compared to the rest of the Gospels, Mark is probably the fastest moving Gospel there is. What I mean by that is that he uses one word repeatedly, which is the word immediately. Jesus is here and immediately goes here and here and here. Like in the first chapter, he uses that word 8 times. It's almost like he's trying to catch his breath. And some would say there is as much omitted from Mark. We don't have the genealogy of Jesus. We don't have the birth stories. No wise men, no shepherds, no guiding star or seeing angels. We don't have his trip to the temple. We have just a few parables in his. And if you were listening carefully when I said the four Gospels, Mark, Matthew, Luke, and John, I was intentional in doing that because when the Bible was put together, when the New Testament was put together, most scholars believe that Matthew was the earliest Gospel. At a time when we researched and discovered that actually that Mark is the earliest Gospel, written around 50-60 AD, and that Matthew and Luke borrowed heavily from him. So let's look at this man, John Mark. His first name is John, the Jehovah is graceful. But his last name is Mark. In fact, Peter refers to him as Marcus because his last name is Roman. So one would assume that, could safely assume that his father was probably a Roman citizen and that his mother was probably Jewish. An interesting combination in those days. It's possible that his father had passed away. Because there's nothing said about him, but there is about Mary, his mother. In Acts 12 and verse 12, we find Mary, the mother of Mark, or of John Mark. The story is set when Peter has been set free by the angels, set free from prison. And he's saying, where shall I go? And Acts 12 says that, and when he had considered the thing, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many gathered together in prayer. So we learn a lot about his mother. We learn that she was a very gracious woman, that she had the gift of hospitality, that she opened her home as a place of refuge for believers to come and to pray together and to fellowship together. It's probable that her husband had been financially well off because her home was big enough that many believers could come and worship there. She's a woman who's willing to take risk. Now, the Roman government allows for a variety of religions that it deems legal. And Christianity was considered legal because it was under the umbrella of Judaism. For the time when Mark is writing, and the other gospel writers when we'll be writing, Christianity is no longer under the umbrella of Judaism, no longer enjoying that protection, that religious freedom. And we do like religious freedom, don't we? So she's a woman who's willing to take risks. Because a religion that's illegal in Rome, you'd be thrown in prison or fed to the animals, the wild beasts. And we also know that Mary is a woman of prayer. She is a prayer warrior. When Peter decides to go to her house, he goes there because he knows that they are praying for him. So John Mark has the joy and the privilege of hearing stories by many different Christians and missionaries. And he's young and enthusiastic, and he wants to be a missionary. If you looked in the yearbook under his name, it probably said most likely to be a missionary. And so he talks to his cousin Barnabas. And Barnabas invites him to join them. In fact, if you turn to Acts 12:25, tells us that Barnabas and Saul had returned from Jerusalem. They had fulfilled their ministry, and they took with them John, whose surname is Mark. And they began this journey. Sometimes mission trips are more challenging than we expect. We don't know what happened. All we know is that in the midst of the trip, he left the ministry. There's no condemnation, no criticism. But in chapter 15 of Acts, in verse 39, Barnabas wants to give Mark a second chance. Aren't you glad we serve a God of second chances?
Amen.
And there was this discussion, in fact, it says that the contention was so sharp between them, that's between Barnabas and Paul, that they departed and went asunder, and Barnabas took with him young John Mark and became his mentor and helped him to grow in ministry. And we're Americans. We love happy endings to all stories. And this one has that happy ending. 2 Timothy 4:11. Paul's in prison. And he says, only Luke is with me. And he says to Timothy, please bring with you Mark, for he is profitable for me for ministry. And in 1 Peter 5:13, Peter refers to Mark by his Roman name and calls him Marcus. He says, he is my son. Many scholars believe that Mark spent a lot of time with Peter, that Peter became a great mentor for him, and that the gospel of Mark is really the gospel of Peter. And as these two men worked together and traveled together, young John kept a journal of all the stories that Peter had told him about Jesus. Going back to Mark, every book in the Bible has a theme scripture. Mark 10:45 is that scripture. And it focuses on the purpose of that book. Mark 10:45. For even the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give his life a ransom for many. That's worthy of amen, isn't it? Jesus came as a ransom for many. So in John's book, or Mark's book, it's broken into two sections, the suffering servant and the importance of discipleship. If you turn now to Mark 8, verse 34, Jesus gives us an understanding of discipleship. Mark 8:34, when he had called the people unto him with his disciples, also he said unto them, whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. So Jesus is telling his believers, Many will become believers by persecution. If you really want to be a disciple, follow him, no matter where that leads. Verse 35, so whosoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel's, the same shall save it. Jesus knew that his believers would be under attack. He knew they would be persecuted. And he knew they needed words of hope. That even if they gave their life for the ministry, it would not be forgotten. And they would not be abandoned. Verse 36, for what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his soul? For what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him also shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he cometh in the glory of his Father and the holy angels. Mark is writing to Roman Christians, probably around AD 50, AD 60. It's a time of Nero. Nero was throwing Christians into the arena. He fed the wild animals, and he was using Christians as human torches. It was a hard time to be a Christian in the middle of the first century. We enjoy the luxury of religious freedom, and I hope as you plan next Sabbath to give to the religious liberty offering that you will think of the importance of supporting that magazine so that thought leaders can be aware of the importance of maintaining religious freedom. So let's start with chapter 1, verse 1. Mark 1, chapter 1, and verse 1. There's a lot to unpack in this chapter. The beginning of the gospel, Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Now this word gospel, you find it all throughout the New Testament. But if you do a word search, you will not find this word in the Old Testament. In fact, it's a secular word. It's a word used that when a king leads or sends his troops into battle, a messenger comes back and brings him the gospel, brings him the good tidings. Hopefully it's good tidings for that king and his battle was won. It brings him the good tidings, the good news, and the victory has been won. So the word gospel really is a victory word. It's also a technical term that refers not only to victory, but also to sacrifice, and celebration, and reward. And the New Testament is full of good news, full of reasons to celebrate and to praise God. And as Mark starts this gospel, and he says, the gospel of Jesus Christ, he is telling the readers that everything you're going to read for the next 16 chapters is going to be the good news about Jesus Christ, the glad tidings about Jesus Christ. You see, there are three concepts we should learn. That is, the gospel of the kingdom is socially charged. For the first time, regardless of your background, your finances, your gender, everybody is welcome to the kingdom of heaven. That's not something that the people have been hearing. Jesus tells us that everybody is welcome under his umbrella of the kingdom of heaven. Jesus was touched by a woman who was hemorrhaging, which made him unclean. He touched lepers, which made him unclean. He ate with publicans. He ministered to Samaritans. He associated with Gentiles. All of this to show that the kingdom of God is for everybody. That we are all equals in God's kingdom. And secondly, the kingdom of God was economically charged. And that it was initiated by Jesus using the language of Jubilee. So if you hold chapter 1 and then turn over to Luke chapter 4, Jesus makes reference to the Jubilee. Luke 4, verse 18, said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim the good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives, and to recovering the sight of the blind, and to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. The year of Jubilee was a time when, according to the commands of Moses, when every slave would be set free, when every land would be returned to its original family, and every debt would be canceled. This is not just spiritualizing, this is real returning of finances. This is Jesus inviting us to totally, unconditionally trust him. And thirdly, the kingdom of God is politically charged. It proclaimed that Jesus is the Lord, and that we all, as his servants, should bow our knees and recognize his sovereignty. It proclaims that Jesus is the King of Kings. It proclaims that obedience to Jesus, to his words, and his ways, and his calls, triumphs over all other obligations of obedience. Without lifting a sword, without firing a shot, he declared his kingdom. And he proved his authority to do so with a cross and an empty tomb. He is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. He has power over all other powers. And then Mark says, in the beginning was the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Now, Jesus was a common name that Mark is stating, because there's some discussion and confusion in the church as to the nature of Jesus, and Mark is saying that Jesus is a man. He understands what it means to be a man. He understands the trials and the hardships. As Paul said in Hebrews, he has been tempted like as we are. So Mark is establishing the importance of realizing that Jesus is human. And when you go through trials and difficulties or frustrations, Jesus understands what you're going through. And then he calls him the Christ, the Anointed One, God with us. Totally human, totally divine. And then he says he is the Son of God, which means he has power over everything. Even the demons recognize his authority, which is something that the people had not seen or heard of for hundreds of years. Let me come to Mark chapter 1, verses 2 and 3. As it is written in Isaiah the prophet, "Look, I'm sending my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way. The voice of one shouting in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight his paths." Now the fact that Mark doesn't give us an introduction to who John the Baptist is indicates that the readers were familiar with Old Testament prophecies. Because John's ministry was prophesied some 700 years before the time of Christ. And so Mark reaches into the Old Testament. He's quoting Malachi chapter 3, verse 1. "I am about to send my messenger who will clear the way before me." And Isaiah 40, verse 3, "A voice cries in the wilderness, clear a way for the Lord, construct in the desert a road for our God." Before Antioch, when the followers of Jesus Christ were redeemed as Christians, the followers of Christ were called the Way. Notice that Mark uses that word twice. Jesus uses it and says, "I am the Way." And so before we became known as Christians, we were known as the people of the Way. And hopefully we continue to be known as the people of the Word. And John comes out of the wilderness. It's rather interesting picture that Mark paints. John is coming out of the ministry, out of the wilderness to begin his ministry. And Jesus will be driven by the Holy Spirit into the wilderness to begin his ministry as he does battle against Satan. But do not mistake that the wilderness is an empty place. It is inhabited by the diseased who were thrown out of the city. It is inhabited by the disinfected who dropped out, by the debtors who bailed out, by the criminals who hid out, and the unfaithful who ran out. The wilderness was a refuge, a haven for prophets, and a sanctuary for dissidents. It was a dwelling place for sheep and scorpions, for lizards and lions. It was a lodging for shepherds and rebels, the home of the banished men of learning and dangerous men of violence. And John comes out of that environment. He comes out of the wilderness and begins his ministry. Now, if you jump down to verse 6, Mark describes his clothing. So John wore a garment made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate the locusts. It is not missed by his audience that John is dressed as Elijah. In Desire of Ages, the Lord tells us that John understood that he was coming with the Elijah message, and that he had committed his life to being faithful to this promise in Isaiah 40 of being a voice crying in the wilderness, "Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent." It's his message. Repent and be baptized. You know, Elijah was preaching that message, repentance, to God's people. And then they forgot. And so God brings into the picture John the Baptist, who again is crying out, repent. And a lot of people thought maybe that he was Elijah, resurrected. Others thought maybe he was the Messiah. And John clarifies that he's neither. He is the voice of Elijah. He is preaching that Elijah message. Prepare the way. You know, God has called his church to do evangelism, to reach the lost. Sometimes people say, you know, why do we spend all this money on evangelism? You know, the Baptists are doing such a wonderful job preaching about the righteousness of Jesus, about John 3:16. And it's true, they do a wonderful job. But God called this church in existence to preach about Christ and righteousness in the context of Daniel and Revelation. We have a message to share with the world that you're saved by God's grace. That it's not your works and your deeds. That we do works and deeds as a result of our relationship with Jesus Christ. And God has been raising up voices like Jones and Wagner, like Ellen White, like modern day pastors, to continue to appeal to men and women to surrender their lives to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
John says, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Now the Romans were great road builders. The Greeks gave us a common language, a road. The Romans gave us a road to make it easier to share the gospel. And we enjoy good roads. Just think how many times you grumble when you're hitting a pothole. But when Karen and I went to Africa, we discovered a little bit of what John meant. We talked about making those roads. Potholes were, there were more potholes than there were roads. But John says, make straight the path. He's not talking about asphalt. He's talking about our hearts. Make straight. Let all the debris, all the obstacles be set aside, and let Jesus Christ be the King of your heart.
Amen.
Let him transform you. Let him make him mold you. I saw a young man a couple weeks ago carrying a yellow sign, poster sign. He had written it rather crudely, Repent because Jesus is coming. Oh man, it takes a lot of courage to stand on the street corner and do something like that. It took a lot of courage for John to stand up and preach to a church that was not open to this message. And we need to be open to it. John wasn't trying to reach the unchurched. He was trying to reach the church. He was trying to reach God's remnant people and say, we need to be ready today for the soon coming of the Messiah. We have that same message. We need to be ready. And we need to invite our friends and our neighbors to be ready because Jesus Christ is coming soon. When William Miller started preaching the imminent return of Christ, many of the scholars didn't disagree with his process. And just to disagree with this conclusion that Jesus is coming soon. We must not be, like William Miller, we must not be discouraged because Christ is coming soon. In verse 4 it says, in the wilderness, John the baptizer began preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. Christ our righteousness. Is what John was preaching. And he said that when you repent and give your life to Christ, then you become baptized. He says they're like twin brothers. In verse 5, it says, the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him, confessing their sins. They were baptized by him in the Jordan River. I've been involved in a lot of evangelistic events. And we sent out thousands of handbills. There was a time when you sent out 1,000 handbills and 10 people showed up. Today you send out 10,000 handbills and but one person shows up. The word got out that this man dressed in garments that looked like Elijah that is preaching a powerful message. And people began to flock to him. Some were sincere. Others just want to be safe, just in case this guy's right. We'll go ahead and baptize. We'll get baptized into the Jordan River. You remember Elijah, when his ministry was done, he took his cloak off and he struck the River Jordan and it opened up. He and his assistant went across. Elisha. And this message, prepare the heart, make straight the road, is as relevant today as it was in the time of John the Baptist. We can't delay or procrastinate. We need to be ready. It is Jesus' call to discipleship. Now, for decades, maybe even centuries, we've had this idea of salvation upside down. The focus has been our salvation, our sins, our redemption, our healing, our cleansing, our new life. Now those certainly are aspects of salvation. But there's much more than is what God does for us and what he wants us to do for others. So I ask the question to you, what are you doing with your salvation? And before you think I'm going to talk about works, I know. But is there room in your life for being a disciple of Jesus Christ? Or have you plugged into every moment of your life all the things that you want to do that have nothing to do with the kingdom of heaven? Every once in a while, it's good to remind ourselves that the plan of salvation is not only to save us, but to give us a purpose. And that purpose is to prepare the way of the Lord.